Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Life in the Middle Ages by Richard Winston, read by Shaun Grindell. 1. The Medieval Idyll. It is September. The grapes are ripe. A group of peasants stoop among the vines. An ox cart stands by, holding two tubs brimming with purple fruit. A short walk away, over a little drawbridge, is a castle, a cluster of white walls, crocketed eaves, conical roofs, tall chimneys, and gilded weather vanes. A tiny woman, dressed in scarlet, is on her way toward it. She carries a grape-filled basket on her head, steadying it with one arm. The fields are vibrantly green, and the sky ravishingly blue. We take our bearings at once. We are in the heart of the French High Middle Ages. This is the first of the calendar pictures from a book of hours, a book of prayers for private devotion, commissioned by Jean, Duke of Berry, of the House of Valois, in the year 1412. In the catalogue of the Duke's possessions drawn up after his death, the still unbound sheets were described as très riche usure, most rich hours, by the artists, the brothers Lambour, and the description has become the book's title since then. January is for lavish entertaining. Gold and silver utensils glitter on a white-clothed table. The room is crowded with fantastically dressed courtiers. The host himself, enveloped in a robe of blue brocade, sits on a dais close to the fireplace. There is rush matting on the floor, and the wall is hung with a tapestry showing an incident in the Trojan War. The heavy-set man in blue brocade is the Duke of Berry, and the picture celebrates his scale of life and breadth of culture. The next illustration is in total contrast. February shows the wintry yard of a peasant homestead. Sheep huddle in their shed, beehives are capped with snow, and a small flock of magpies peck seed from a fallen wisp of hay. Inside the house, conveniently cross-sectioned, the peasant family hugs the fire. In the far distance, also buried in the snow, is a village, a snow-covered church spire pointing into the cold sky. The scene is overwhelmingly white and speaks of the austerity of winter, the precariousness of humble shelter, the narrow margin by which men and women and animals survive. By March, the snow is gone. The illustration shows a medieval estate with its many subdivided fields. Again, there is a castle in the distance. The sky has a lowering look. The earth is still dark and sullen, but lambs have been born in the upland pasture, and it is not too early to be pruning fruit trees. In the foreground, a peasant is guiding his plough through the field. The oxen strain, muscles rippling under their hides. The peasant, an old man in torn clothing, also shows arthritic stiffness in his posture. April is for betrothals. Again, we are in the company of nobles, privileged young people in fine clothing and plumed hats. A ring is being offered. The picture may record the engagement of Charles d'Orléans to Bonne d'Armagnac, an event that would have been very much in the Duke of Berry's sphere of interest, for he was Bonne's grandfather and Charles's granduncle. The match brought together two of the most high-born and exemplary young people in France, besides having enormous political implications. Charles was 15 and Bonne was 11, but that was not so uncommonly young, and the principals conducted themselves like grown-ups. The marriage was a happy one, but it was to be pitifully curtailed. Charles was 21 when he was taken prisoner by the English at the Battle of Agincourt. He was to turn his young man's energies entirely to poetry in the years to come, for he remained 25 years in the hands of his English captors. He chafed at his helplessness, grieved at the news from France. Often his thoughts turned to his young wife. "When I must lie in bed at night, thought and desire overcome me, and many times I think I hold you in my arms, dearest mine, and I clasp my pillow and cry." Midway in that long stretch of years, news came to him that Bonne had died. No cause of death was given, and none was asked for. Inexplicable deaths were part of the natural order of things. Less natural was the political turbulence over the years in which so many of Charles's friends and partisans were killed. His country was racked by war and anarchy, its sound peasantry ruined and brutalized. But when this little April scene was painted, none of this could have been foreseen. No shadows darken the glade where the engagement party is held. May is also a noble scene. Lords and ladies go out riding. The green mantles of the ladies symbolize joy, and most of the riders have decked themselves with wreaths of small spring leaves. The party will reappear once again in August, and again on horseback, the ladies in summer dresses and with their hair confined by filmy wimples. In the August picture, peasants share the scene. Some are cutting ripened wheat, others swim in the river. The landscape shimmers palely in the summer heat. On the whole, though, the calendar pictures of peasant labour outnumber those of noble pastime. Peasants had figured often enough in medieval iconography, but always in a subsidiary capacity. This is the first instance of their being shown as the chief characters in the scene, and in a purely secular context. This new position of the peasant reflected an intellectual and religious current of the time, a sort of mystical interest in the common person. The Lambour brothers infused the subject with personal feeling. They came from the lowlands, where already there was strong tradition of artisan protest against social inequity. Moreover, en lumière were artisans themselves. The pictures have a magic quality, excluding the astrological chart crowning them. Each is barely 6 inches by 5 inches, little larger than a picture postcard, but they draw one into a full-sized world. Here on the inside, everything is startlingly realistic. These pictures were surely painted with the aid of a jeweler's loop, and are best studied through a magnifying glass. Through the lens, they reveal a further range of differentiation and private illusion. The same pet dogs recur. Toy terriers allowed to jump on the ducal table in January, and later, grown perceptibly bigger, to tag along with the maying party. The faces of the nobles and ladies are portraits. The brocaded garment, furred hat, and gold collar of the January picture are actual items from the ducal wardrobe, and the tapestry is a prized one from the Duke's collection. The young men whose grey-blue stocking cap set them apart from the fine bonneted nobles of the feast are believed to be Paul and Jean Lambour themselves. As for the castle in the background of each picture, they are real buildings, accurately represented down to the smallest detail, and each, if not the property of the Duke, was intimately connected with his life. But not only the aristocratic details have been treated with this kind of respect. As lovingly recorded are the bungholes of barrels, stones in ploughland, reeds rimming a stream, implements in the hands of peasants. We see in the very ropes that manipulate a drawbridge minute figures of women kneeling on the riverbank to do washing and scraps of cloth strung out over a newly planted field to keep the birds away. It is the holiness of the everyday that the calendar pictures celebrate, the cycle of nature, the round of simple essential activities performed by peasants and domestic animals. It is peace and normality. A beautiful world, we are painfully conscious of our distance from it and the hopelessness of wishing it back. Nor are we so sure we would like those pre-industrial patterns. We would hardly want to be plunged into the insecurities of medieval life. In a scarcity economy, famine was inescapable. In the absence of scientific knowledge, there was no defense against disease. Although medieval wars were minor operations by our standards, the army small, the weapons simple, the battlegrounds were entire countries, and the devastation was cruel enough in terms of human suffering. We cannot help shuddering at the harshness of the legal system. We shudder also at the guilt and terror instilled in the medieval psyche in the name of religion. No, we cannot fall into the illusions of the 19th century romantics who thought they could take the good of the agrarian world and leave out the bad. We have some idea of how all these things hang together. As for the Duke of Berry, that world was also becoming irrecoverable for him. Even as those gifted boys, Paul and Jean and Hermann Lambourg, were creating their magic model of it. The Duke hardly went back to Berry these days. He stayed on in the capital, keeping watch on the perilous political situation. As it worsened, he delved increasingly into fields remote from the present. He consulted with astrologers and learned men who supplied the data for the complicated charts of his psalters. He commissioned translations of classical works, Horace, Livy, Terence. He bought one of the first copies made in France of Virgil's Eclogues and Georgics. He collected ancient coins and cameos and medals of Roman emperors. But the great consolation of his last years was watching the Lambour brothers. He dropped in on their workshop daily, followed the progress of each of the pictures, and perhaps suggested many of the details. They had hardly finished one set of the illuminations when the Duke had another project for them. He gave them diamond rings as New Year's presents. Even the account slips that record some of his payments to them strike a note of affection. To Paul of Lambour, in consideration of the good and welcome services he has rendered, renders each day, and that is hoped will render in the future, and also to clothe himself and to be more honourably in the Duke's service, notwithstanding the other gifts given him by the Duke, 100 écus. The last commission was never finished. By the autumn of 1416, all three of the talented brothers were dead. The Duke himself died on June 15th of that year and was buried in Bourges, his tomb carved with an inscription he himself selected. What is noble birth? What is riches? What is glory? Look upon me, for an instant all was mine. Now I have nothing. The records offer no explanation of these coincidental deaths. However, we can guess that patron and painters, whose fame will remain forever linked, were carried off by one of those flare-ups of the plague that occurred at intervals of 3 or 4 years throughout the most troubled period in French history. On a less mystical plane, the war that rent France was a struggle among the princes of the realm for what the age called lordships and treasure, power and wealth. Marie's brother Charles V had barely breathed his last when the conflict began. It was aggravated by the fact that the heir was only 12 years old, further aggravated when it became evident that the boy king was mentally ill. A struggle for control of the boy and of France began between the Duke of Burgundy and the Duke of Orléans. France was split between their partisans. Division of opinion became civil war after the brutal assassination of Louis d'Orléans. The English took advantage of the turbulent situation to invade France. The war became three-sided, with the Orléans party, now headed by the Duke of Armagnac, fighting both the Burgundians and the English. For a time, three-quarters of France was under English occupation, but the disruption and chaos caused by the war were even more tragic than the fighting. Hence, the pictures of Tre Richeuseur represent, even within the context of their times, a lost idyll. 2. Peasant France. When the English army made its landing in Normandy in 1346, the first major operation of the Hundred Years' War, Edward III found a land worth the looting. As the chronicler Jean Froissart described it, the country is prosperous and plenteous in all things, the barns full of grain, the houses full of rich goods, rich burghers, wagons, carts, horses, swine, eyes, sheep, and the most beautiful castle in the world. In the Middle Ages, wealth was still based largely on the produce of the land, and France was blessed beyond the other nations of Europe in this respect. At that midpoint in the 14th century, the dimensions of France were remarkably close to what they are today, which meant that it was the largest country in Europe. A program of reclamation during the previous two centuries had significantly increased the amount of arable land. Marshes had been drained and heaths put to the plow. Wooded areas had been greatly reduced, and some forests had been entirely cleared. An enormous surge of energy seems to have accompanied this expansionist impulse. With it was associated a dramatic rise in population to some 15 million, relatively enormous for medieval conditions, and far greater, for example, than the population of England. Hence, there were enough people to work the new lands, as well as to make possible the founding of the many towns that sprang into being. Much of this land clearing was undertaken by the monastic orders, especially the Cistercians and Premonstratensians, which, being new orders, had to create a source of revenue for themselves. Ancient long-established abbeys like St. Denis also saw the merit of profit in enlarging their tillage. The nobles, too, grasped at the opportunity to better exploit their holdings. But the labour itself, chopping trees and pulled roots, hauling rock, burning off briars, ditching, levelling land with mattock and spade, was the peasants' accomplishment. There was no lack of hands, for the peasants were everywhere. In spite of the burgeoning towns, the vast majority of the population still consisted of the peasantry.
In fact, a large proportion of the townsfolk made their living from the land and went out daily to tend their fields, which lay directly outside town walls.
The ordinary artisan was only a step away from his peasant origin. Domestic servants came from the peasant class, as did those bands of day labourers and draymen who played an essential part in the energetic building programmes and public works of the period. The miller, the baker, the cattle dealer were also solidly entrenched in peasant society, though they might be on their way to bourgeois standing. And as the times darkened and war came to be an almost permanent condition throughout most of France, the lowest-ranking fighting men, a man-at-arms or lance or helmet as he was called, was again a peasant who had been lured from his plough by the promise of pay or booty, or had taken up soldiering because war had stripped him of the means to go on farming. But let us look at the peasant in his purest form.
as he appears in the countless miniatures of the period, single-mindedly engaged in his rustic pursuits. He is generally shown as a sturdy figure, rather on the clumsy side, though the peasant womenfolk are portrayed with more kindness, sometimes even as undeniably pretty. The peasant's everyday clothing was simple and functional and timeless. He was certainly no dandy, though he liked the colour of the homespun cloth of his garments. Reds, blues, browns, and even pinks. He wore a loose smock down to his knees, girded at the waist with a belt. In winter, this was of wool, in summer of linen or hempen cloth. For cold weather, he had a cloak and knee-length breeches. He covered his legs with stockings, probably knitted by his wife or mother. When he was out haying in the heat of July, he preferred to go barefoot and have on a minimum of clothing. Only the loose, knee-length blouse. A straw hat or a scarf about his head kept off the sun. When working in the barnyard muck, he wore wooden clogs, and when ploughing or chopping wood, strong-soled boots. But he also owned fancier shoes of soft black leather, with the goose-foot shape characteristics of the time, their tops pulled up above the ankles. For festive occasions, church-going or trips to the market, a prosperous peasant had better clothes, the blouse cut of finer cloth and with some art. It was a joke at the time that the peasant did without underclothes. The standards for women of the peasant class provided for greater modesty. They had long linen petticoats under their gowns. The gowns, too, had a timeless cut, a close-fitting bodice, then a gracefully gathered skirt of the same or contrasting colour. Blues and purples were favoured. The bodice might be low-necked, short-sleeved, and laced together between the breasts. This would have been convenient for nursing. A white linen blouse was worn underneath, its sleeve showing. Women kept their hair in place with scarves while doing outdoor work. Shoes were as necessary to women as men, for they too were out in the fields and tending the animals most of the day. If we may judge by the pictures, the women had good figures on the whole, in spite of many pregnancies. While noble women were in a similar state much of the time, the conventions of the period called for a tacit overlooking of pregnancy in the upper classes. The peasant lived in a low house of not more than two or three rooms. The main room was used for cooking, eating, and household industries. The family slept in the next room. If there was an overflow of children, a third room would be built on. This was easily done, for the building was generally made of wattle and daub. There are still many houses of this sort in Europe, though of a later period and superior workmanship. They illustrate the basic mode of construction. As the medieval peasant went about it, he put up a double palisade of sticks around a frame of stout timber. The space between the sticks was filled with straw and rubble. The outside was plastered with clay. Rafters were made of heavier branches, then covered with thatch. There were few window openings, and these were small. Window glass was a luxury beyond the peasant's means. The windows were closed against the cold by wooden shutters. There was a hearth at one end of the main room for cooking and heating, but a chimney presented a complicated construction problem and might be absent from the average peasant dwelling. The smoke would simply accumulate up near the eaves and find its way out through the thatch. The peasant built with what he could procure from the forest, riverbank, and stubble field. He used a minimum of worked lumber and hired no carpenters. The inside of the peasant's house was not as cheerless as it is sometimes represented. There were pieces of household furniture, a bed for the parents, perhaps with a carved wood headboard, a cradle for the youngest, and a bed in another room for the rest of the children. Peasants slept on straw, but they could supply themselves with goose-down bolsters or woolen coverlets. They had tables, stools, benches, homemade pieces, stout and utilitarian, the wood polished from hard use. There were a number of chests and cupboards for storing clothes and foodstuffs. A few shelves mounted on the wall held the family dishware. It is often assumed that the peasant family did without plates. This is not true. Earthenware dishes of the common unglazed type were locally produced, and any peasant could afford them, as well as bowls and jugs. He also had wooden platters, bowls and drinking cups. Horn spoons and wooden ladles were in use. Though metal was scarce and expensive, each family owned a few iron pots, as well as an iron trivet and a spit for roasting meats. Loosely grouped around this dwelling were the outbuildings. These were built of the same materials as the house, except for a small granary made of stone to keep out rats and mice. The miniatures show such family compounds surrounded by wattle fences and looking well kept and cheerful. The medieval peasant thought of his home in terms of permanence. Even if he had settled in a given district fairly recently, as in one of the new lands, he expected that he and his descendants would remain there for an indefinite stretch of time. In fact, most French villages are still on the same sites they occupied in the 12th century or earlier. There was space enough around each house for a patch of vegetables, a few vines, fruit trees, a hayrick. Paths and lanes led to the village centre, to a water source, and to the small stone church flanked by a cemetery. Larger roads led to the fields. The peasant lived close to his neighbours. Hamlets and villages, rather than farmhouses, were the rule. These had been shaped by the earlier form of feudal society, where the serfs lived clustered around the manor house for protection. Historians have surmised that the feudal manor was born in the dark reaches of the past, from the union of two distinct institutions, the Roman estate and the Celtic Germanic village. The Roman system was based on slavery. Its agricultural techniques were highly advanced, and it produced considerable surpluses intended for sale elsewhere. It presupposed a complex urban society. The Celtic Germanic village was a far more primitive unit. There, a rude agriculture was combined with hunting and animal husbandry. The tribe was an association of equals under a, perhaps elected, chieftain, bent on the humble but not so easily attained goal of self-sufficiency. It also functioned as a military unit, defending its territories against incursions of other bands. Elements of both institutions can be seen in the early medieval manor. In the course of a millennium, slavery had disappeared, to be replaced by serfdom. Like the slave, the serf did not own the land he tilled. Possession of the land was vested in the lord or in some arm of the church. The serf, however, owned himself. He was no longer a chattel to be bought and sold. He could live in his own house, in the intimacy of his own family. He was a Christian and thus had a value as a child of God that had never been accorded the Roman slave. However, he was obligated to his lord for a great deal, and his indebtedness conditioned his entire existence. In a sense, the lord was his state, from whom fundamental blessings flowed. The right to share in the land, on which the serf's physical continuance depended. A place in a stable community, so important for his social continuance. Moreover, the lord saw to his people's spiritual needs by maintaining a church and a priest, whose masses and sacraments guaranteed eternal salvation. During many turbulent centuries in which these relationships were forged, the lord was often the only visible organizing power. The prerogatives that fell to him were not due to sheer brutal usurpation, but resulted from consent and sometimes even a clear agreement between ruler and ruled. The lord kept his part of the bargain in various ways. He was supposed to maintain some military force to deter and repel attacks. He provided a fortified area where the serfs and their animals could take refuge in times of danger. He built a communal cellar for storing wine. He kept the breeding stock that serviced the village animals. He took over the management of roads, bridges, and ferries. He acted as a judge, settling quarrels and enforcing morality. In times of want, he gave succor to his people from his own surplus. In return, the serfs of a manor maintained the lord on a scale befitting his rank. They worked on the lord's private fields, which were, in any case, the most productive. Tending these took priority over their own planting and harvesting. They cut the firewood he needed to heat the castle or manor house where he lived, with his retinue of hangers-on and attendants. They themselves acted as such personal attendants or sent their children to serve in the lord's kitchens and stables. They would also be assigned tasks in the lord's workshops, for the manor was a largely self-sufficient unit, like the serf's own household. In addition to these obligatory labours, which claimed half his time and strength, the serf had to deliver some of his own produce to the lord's storehouse. There were various fees to pay, for the right to marry outside the manor, for instance. A death tax was collected, usually in the form of a sheep or a cow, before a serf's heir could step into his father's tenure. In addition, in theory, the lord could call on his people for all kinds of special donations. These were known as aids and came up when the lord needed special revenues, for his daughter's marriage, for his son's knighting, for a military expedition, or an improvement to his property. The aids were, in a sense, half voluntary. On the other hand, the lord could ask for them as he pleased. Such ambiguities were typical of these medieval arrangements.
The lord's exactions were onerous and were clearly felt as such. They were also subject to modification, for the relationship of lord to serf was a living, flexible one. The lord was not necessarily pitiless, though his steward might be. Particularly when they acted as a group, serfs had considerable bargaining power. The surge of prosperity that swept Europe from the 11th century onward had a perceptible effect on the manorial system. The opening of new lands represented a temptation and an opportunity. The proprietors of these large tracts, lords or monastic orders, actively recruited settlers, promising them ample holdings and easy conditions of tenure. Lords on established manors, seeing the need to keep their labor forces, had to match these terms. With the growth of towns and the general diversification of society, choices widened. The upshot of these developments, which continued for centuries, was a new rural reality. The arrangements between lord and serf had been liberalized to an extent that would have astonished anyone who might have viewed the older manorial order as an immutable, God-given state of affairs. In fact, the word serf disappears from the documents and perhaps from the common speech of the time. Instead, we find references to villeinage, an old term too, but one applying to a condition several cuts above the servitude of yore. The word villein has none of the derogatory overtones of near slavery. It means a man of the village, or a countryman. De facto, if not de jure, the villein owned the acres he worked, since he could buy and sell land and pass it on to his children. The arbitrary exactions of earlier times had been regularized into fixed payments on an annual basis. In effect, the villein owed a rent for his house and land to his lord. This was paid either in money or in kind. There were also crop-sharing agreements, which varied from place to place and person to person. These too gradually developed to the advantage of the peasant. There are only scanty written documents through these many centuries relating to land tenure or the reciprocal obligations of lord and villein. A few juridical decisions or inventories of lords' properties are all we have. It was characteristic of the Middle Ages that custom had a well-nigh sacred force. Things were done as they had been done before, and when, with the death of one or another party, doubts arose, the question at issue was decided by the recollection of witnesses. The memory of man was the legal phrase. This judicial principle, which permeated the whole of society, was strongest of all in rural affairs. Oddly enough, such a system, far from being rigid, was remarkably flexible, especially where self-interest and fine points about boundaries or payments were involved. And so, over the years, arrangements were gradually altered, sometimes in favor of the lord, sometimes in favor of the peasants, and a rough justice prevailed. The outcome of slow evolution over the centuries had been the gradual dismemberment of the lord's vast domains. His holdings were to a great extent parcelled out among the peasants, although peasants rarely worked a large solid block of property. Because of the fortuitous ways in which peasant holdings accumulated, the individual peasant was apt to farm bits and pieces all over the estate or the village. A strip here or a strip there would be inherited from father or mother, acquired as dowry, brought in a good year, or privately without.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.